Hello everyone, I'm Dennis Burns from Woodsongs in Boulder, Colorado. Welcome to our sixth video in the Musicianship series. This one is called Chord Mapping and Beginning Improvisation. So in the last video, I showed you how to create chords on a piano. So now we're going to take two of the chords out of the key of C and talk about how you isolate them on the guitar and visualize them. Okay, so let's go to that virtual keyboard that we were using before. And remember, so the white keys is all we're working with. We're starting on C and we're going up to the next C. C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. That's all the notes we're using. To create a C triad, we go every other note with the white keys. C, E, G, that's called a triad. That's the one chord in the key of C. If I go up to the fifth note of the scale, which is the G note, and I do the same process, I get G, B, and D. That's called the five chord. In the tune we're going to use as an example today, which is Jambalaya by Hank Williams, which is a great tune. We're gonna make a G7. So the question always arises, well, what's the difference between a G and a G7? The difference is, instead of going 1, 3, 5, we go 1, 3, 5, 7. So we go one step further in our building of thirds. So a G7 chord is G, B, D, and F. Okay, and that F adds a lot more tension to the chord. That really wants to resolve back to the one chord. So you hear that sound a lot in classical music, the endings of symphonies by like Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven. That's 5-1, 5-1, 5-1. 5-1, okay? That's what that sound is. So, let's take a look at, let's get rid of that virtual keyboard. It always messes with my audio system. Let's take a look at Photoshop here for a moment. So now what you see at the top, it says C chord open. And you see our chord mapping, excuse me, scale mapping. Or note mapping is what we called it in the previous lesson. But now you have certain notes that are highlighted in orange. So we're spelling out the C chord and we're highlighting every C, E, and G in the first three frets of the guitar. And I call this open position here because whenever possible, we're going to use an open string in this particular approach. So, a C chord, remember, is C, E, and G. Let's begin with the C. So here's C. And remember, this diagram is like you're looking down at your guitar this way. Okay? So there's our lowest C on the guitar. We jump to the E here on the fourth string, and then we play open G. So if I do that, we just get this sound. We just get C, E, and G. So that's a C chord right there. That's a totally legitimate C chord. The problem with that chord on the guitar, if you're strumming songs, is there's other strings you're going to hit if you only try to hit those three strings. So what we end up doing on the guitar is we duplicate some of those three notes, that C, E, or G. So if we go back to the C note now on the second string, which is right here, and we play open E, then we have this C, and this open E. If I combine that with the lower C, E, and G, eureka, we have a C chord. So that is why a C chord is a C chord, okay? It's simply the notes C, E, and G in one part of the guitar, fingered so it's easy to do. There's lots of ways to play those three notes. I could play up the fifth string and play C, E, and G. But that's not very convenient as far as strumming, right? Because one note cancels out the next note. That's moving up a string. And that's a valid way to practice it. That might be really good in playing melodic lines. Along the fifth string. But for now, we're talking about chords that lay out among the first three frets of the guitar for convenience, okay? So take a look at this other diagram I drew. I didn't have time to Photoshop this one. Different voicings of C and G. Notice the left top diagram here. What I have in circles is the basic fingering of a C chord, right? That's what everybody learns as their first C chord on the guitar. The notes above are the open strings. Those are the ones people take for granted that they don't realize that's actually part of the chord as well, okay? So that's one possible fingering of a C chord. But since a C chord has C, E, and G in it, I could possibly potentially play this high G note right here instead of the open E. That gives me what's called a different voicing of a C chord. So when I play a C chord, I could play it like this, which is the way you typically first learn it. But you could add the G note down here on your fourth finger and put that on top of the C chord. That's still a C chord, okay? It's absolutely legitimate. These are called different voicings of chords. Look at the one down here, the C chord, Roman numeral 3. Here's your basic C chord again, fingered here, that everybody first learns. But you could also play the low G below that, here. And if you put that together with the fingering you learned previously, the basic C chord, you have this. So this is a real common fingering for strumming. It actually, if you want to hit all six strings and not worry about what you hit, this is the best fingering for a C chord. Okay, let me go back to my basic map here now. So let's go back to the C open chord. So now we can practice what's called an arpeggio. An arpeggio is when you play the notes of a chord one note at a time, okay? So that first C there on the fifth string, I'm going to begin here, and I'm going to go to the E here. I'm going to go to the open G. I'm going to go to the C. I'm going to go to open E, and then G on the first string. So that would sound like this. So I played C, E, G, C, E, G. Okay. Practice it going forward and backward. G, E, C, G, E, C. Sometimes you want them to ring, sometimes you don't. You could hold down the C chord shape and simply go like this. And then add the high G. But for right now, I think it's more valuable to think of it in terms of single notes, like you're playing a saxophone or a flute. Just imagine you're playing an instrument where you can't play more than one note at a time. So just think of C, E, G open, C, hold it down, open, E, G, and then come backward. Then go below that note, go down to that G, go down to the open E, and we could go down to a lower C if we had one, but we don't have one, so we have to come back to G, and on the C. So try to always start on C as your reference, so your ear is hearing that very clearly. So the white notes that are not marked in orange, well, including the notes in orange, I should say, those are your natural notes, right? Those are the notes I had you map out in a previous lesson. So if I just play those, if I start on my low E and I play E, F, G, and then I play A, B, C on the next string, D, E, F, G and A, and I'm going to go to open B, and then E, F, G. So those are all the natural notes. If I start on the C note and I do that, I get a C major scale. And if I end on C, that's an octave, that's eight notes. I can go a little bit further in this particular fingering because we're just using pretty much the first three frets of the instrument for the time being. Right? So you need to practice that and say those notes to yourself over and over. So that brings up another question. How do I practice scales? There's lots of ways to practice scales. But for now, just to keep it simple, what I would suggest you do, start on C, think of that as your center of gravity, and just have a very slow, even beat established. Use a metronome. Metronomes are great. I know they drive people crazy. They're kind of obnoxious sounding. And I'll show you another alternative to using a metronome later in this lesson. But for now, set the metronome to a slow beat. Play each note once. Okay, play it descending. Doesn't matter what your technique is, if you're using your guitar pick or using your thumb to play those notes, or you're doing classical guitar technique where you're alternating the index and middle finger, all of those are fine. I don't want to get into a discussion of what's better and which one has an advantage. It's not important for now. The next step is, once you have that fundamental beat set, play each note twice as fast, double the note, play each note twice. Once you've done that, take that same rhythm but play each note just once. Then go below that C note. Go from the C note on the second string, go up higher. Say the notes to yourself as you're playing. C, D, E, F, G, F, E, D, C. Right? C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. Down below. C, B, A, G, F, E. Come back up. E, F, G, A, B, C. So that's just a real quick introduction to practicing scales. One thing with scales you're shooting for is a nice legato or smooth connection between the notes. That's the key thing. So how does that happen? Well, in short, there's lots of different ways to work on this, but what has to really happen is the left and right hand playing the guitar is a two-handed experience, right? The left and right hand have to be synchronized. So at the moment you play that C note, the C note with the left hand, plucking it with the right hand, has to be down. The left and right hand have to be synchronized with each other. You have to feel them connected. So, you know, if you're getting this kind of sound, like that's called staccato. You have separation between the notes. That's what we do not want. So if you synchronize the left and right hand, you'll get a smooth sounding scale. Maybe we can get into scales in some other lesson, but I don't want to get too lost in the weeds on that one. So, how do you practice arpeggios? Well, you should practice the first triad. You start on C, play C, E, G. Play it backward, G, E, C. Just live with that one for a while. Play it, say it. Once you have that, go up to the next C. C, E, G. Play it backward. Go down to the low C again. C, go down to G, E, back to G, back to C. Okay, so that's how you can practice your C chord arpeggio. All right, let's talk about the tune now. Let's talk about how we might use this. So let's go to Hank Williams doing this song, and I'm going to show you another app, and I highly recommend you get this app. It's called iRealPro. I can't say enough good things about it. It's a great practice tool. A lot of people, students say to me, oh, I hate the metronome. I don't want to play with a metronome. I just can't stand the sound of it. iRealPro is sort of a glorified metronome, but it's much, much more than that. It's like a backing band that you can practice against, and it's all, you know, in the software world. So they make it for iOS, Apple products, iPhone, iPad. They make it for the Android, and I also found out recently they have it for the Macintosh desktop, you know, OS X operating system as well, which I just bought, and you'll see it in action here. So let's listen to a little bit of Hank Williams, and I'm going to switch over to iRealB so you can see kind of what's going on here.
Goodbye, Joe, me gotta go, me oh my oh. Me gotta go, pull the P-Row down the bayou. My Yvonne, the sweetest one, me oh my oh. Son of a gun, we'll have big fun on the bayou.
Okay, so I was trying to follow the chord changes with my mouse and was not doing a very good job. So the first thing about this tune is just get familiar with it. Listen to it over and over. Sing with it. Feel the beat, okay? Clap your hands. Sing. Just get it in your bones. That's the most important thing. So the chord progression goes like this. If we start at letter A here, the top four bars is the intro. We'll ignore that for the moment. C for four beats, which is one measure. One, two, three, four, C again, three, four. G7 for two measures. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. That's a four bar phrase right there. Next line, G7 for four beats. One, two, three, four. Another four. Two, three, four. That makes two measures. And C for two measures. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. That's the whole tune right there. Just over and over with different lyrics, different melodies. If you think about the way the phrasing works, he sings the word goodbye about up here. Goodbye, Joe. Me gotta go. Me oh my oh. That's the end of the first phrase. Then we have a pickup leading into the next phrase. Me gotta go, pull the P-Row down the bayou. My Yvonne, right, and so on. So that's kind of the basic phrasing of the tune. It's good to understand that whole four-bar phrase concept. That's very important. Okay, so now what are we gonna do? We're going to talk about this app called iRealPro that I'm using. This is great to practice against. So one thing we can do with this is we can highlight a certain number of measures. It has to be more than one measure. And you can create a loop. So I can just have this C chord that I have highlighted in yellow now play in a circle for me over and over again. And you'll notice I've got a kind of a Cajun beat set up here in this application. You can change the styles. You could play Jambalaya with a foxtrot beat if you wanted to. It's a lot of fun to play with. But for now, we will use the New Orleans swing. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to play the notes of a C chord against this, since it's playing a C chord for me in a circle. And I just want to show you what happens when you play only the notes of a chord against somebody else playing that same chord, or a group behind you, or a friend strumming a C chord. Okay, I'll get my headphones on here. Okay. Oh, I hate headphones. Okay. So, what'd you think of that? It's a little boring, right? Why is it boring? It's boring because I'm playing the same notes that the chordal instruments are playing. I'm not playing any of the notes other than C, E, and G in a C chord. So it's important. What we do is we're going to use, if I go back to Photoshop here, we're going to use all these notes in my improvisation that are in that first diagram. But we're going to emphasize notes of the C chord while the C chord is being played. So how do you emphasize notes? Well, you play them more frequently. You might practice ending on a note in a chord when you finish a musical idea. For example, very simple phrase. I ended on a G note. I know the chord is a C chord, which has the notes C, E, and G. So I know when I come to rest that that note will resolve very nicely with a C chord because it's part of the chord. So that's a real simple exercise. Play a musical idea and land on a note in the chord that is being played at that moment in time. Let that note ring. It will always work, okay? And just a word, a word about improvisation. People say, well, how could I possibly improvise? I've never done that in my life. I can't just learn it like that. It takes time to learn it, but you have to dive in. And first thing I would suggest you do is, as you're playing, practice singing with your playing. In other words, just hum along. The reason you want to do that is then you'll phrase more naturally, because you have to breathe, right? If you're singing, you have to breathe every now and then. The guitar, any of these plucked instruments, they're not instruments you have to breathe into. And that tends to make people play more mechanically sometimes, not always. It's great to hear somebody playing really fast and flashy and, you know, quick. But that can get old after a while. The main thing is to play, you know, nice musical phrases. That's really what we're shooting for. So let's go back to the iRealPro program, and I'm going to play that C chord loop again. And you can create a loop by just dragging your mouse, and on the iPhone or Android, you can drag your finger across the screen and just have it play that C over and over for you. So now what I'll do is I'll highlight the notes of the C chord. I'll play notes of the C scale, the entire scale, but I'm going to emphasize notes of the C chord. All right, here we go. Get the idea? Much more interesting. Okay. Let's talk about the G7 chord now. So if I go back to Photoshop here, let's take a look where it says G chord open down here. Why won't it let me scroll? Okay, I guess it's not going to work for me. So remember, the notes of a G chord are G, B, and D. And we have them mapped out in orange right here. G, B, D, and then the next G, B, D, and then a high G. So you want to practice that arpeggio first. Just say it, play it, reinforce it. G, B, open D, open G, B, D, high G. Play it backward. Okay. Maybe practice it with the scale that's written behind it that is not highlighted in orange. How would you emphasize the notes of the G chord while you're practicing the scale? Well, you might play them louder. You might go E, F, G, play a strong G, A, B, play it strong, D, excuse me, C, and D strong. That's one way to do it. You could play the notes of the chord you're working on twice. You could do something like, and so on, right? Now remember the G7 chord. But this is just a diagram of the G chord. The G7 has a F in it. So it has, we can add the F here if we want to make the sound of the G7 chord in our solo. We could add that F. We could add this low F if we wanted. And we could add the high F as well. So let's go back to iRealPro. And I'm going to now run a loop on G7. And I'm going to start out just playing notes of the G7 chord. and then I will integrate some of the scale notes behind it, okay? If you have this software, I highly recommend you get it regardless. It's not expensive. It's like $14 for the iOS and Android version and $20 for your desktop Mac. There might be a desktop version for the PC. I haven't researched that, but you can check it out. So now what I can do is just play the tune, right? I can put on the chord changes, and I'm just going to be listening for that G7 moving to the C chord, right? And by the way, the top four measures, that's the introduction. Usually songs start on the first, the key of the song. In other words, usually a song in the key of C starts with a C chord, but sometimes they lead into it with other chords and they eventually arrive on C. And that's what happens here in those first four bars. You can see G7 leads into C, right? So that's not that uncommon. So let me just play against it now. And I'll just play these open position fingerings, and I'll be thinking in my mind the notes in the chord that I'm playing against a little bit, but I'll also be using the overall scale in the background, which is just the natural notes, right? C, D, E, F, G, A, B, and C. Okay, here we go. So that is just using, excuse me, I dropped my pick. That was just using the position, the first position of the guitar. I was using the open strings. So now let's go back to Photoshop here and look at the diagram now of closed chords. So take a look at this one now. It says C closed. So what I'm doing here is I'm trying to not use any open strings. So when I play my C, I'll just use my mouse to show you this. C, I go to E here. Instead of going to open G here, I'm gonna use the G here, fretted on the fifth fret of the fourth string. And then since I'm in that neighborhood, I'm gonna go to the C here, right next to it. Instead of playing open E up here, I'm gonna play the E here. And then I'm gonna go to G, right? So now I can practice my arpeggio in what I would call a closed fingering for a C chord, C, E, and G, right? So here's my C, here's the E, my G is now fretted on the fifth fret of the fourth string. There's one triad of C major. Then I'm gonna go up to the next C, here. Fifth fret, cross over to the second string, fifth fret, and then cross over to the first string, third fret. So my closed C chord arpeggio. Go down to that low G. Maybe play the open E since that's the only place we can possibly play it. Return to C, okay? take a look at the G chord shape now, down here. We're going to do that same process, closed. So if you follow my mouse, G, B, instead of playing open D, I'm going to play the D here. So there's my first triad, G, B, D. And then here I'm going to go G, B, D. I'm not going to use any open strings. And then my high G. So the first triad would be this. G, B, D. Next triad, G, B, D. And then my high G. Play it forward, play it backward. Reinforce it. Say the note names. G, B, D, G, B, D, G. G, D, B, G, D, B, G. Okay? Now if I go back to Jambalaya here in my iRealPro app, now I'm going to try not to use any open strings. And I'll just improvise against the G and C7. Excuse me, C and G7. Is I'm going to combine both of those fingering patterns. So I might play in my C arpeggio up here, open, but then I might jump up to the fretted C arpeggio. And same thing with the scale. I might play my E and F here, and then I'll slide up to my G rather than my open G. Why would you use the fretted G rather than the open G? Well, you can slide to it. It has a different tonal quality. You could hammer to it. You can't do that when you're crossing strings. So basically you're expanding your map from the open strings as a choice to the fretted strings. And all of this becomes one big picture. That's really what you're shooting for. Okay, so let's start at the top again. And I'll just mix it up. So now, how can we make things even more interesting from there? Well, do some slides. If you know what a hammer-on and a pull-off is, do some of those. That will soften up the sound so every note is not always plucked, right? You want to go from G to A, slide it. It's a different sound than this, right? That's called a different articulation. And remember on the G7, touch on that F note, right? That will bring out the sound of the chord. Right? The F down here. Maybe the low F. Maybe not quite so much. Okay? Another thing we can use are what are called chromatic notes or passing tones. So what that means is, let's say I'm on a F note and I want to go to a G note. I can use the note that lays between them. That is F sharp. That's one of the black keys on the piano. Feel free to experiment with those. Generally, you pass through those notes relatively quickly. You won't sit on them, okay? And you can think about how does that work in a chord. For example, the F note is part of the G7 chord, right? And when I go back to the C note, maybe I want to get to my G note. The F sharp lays between. Right? So those are called chromatic notes or passing tones. You can approach any note you want from a half step below, one fret below, or one fret above. For example, if I want to go G down to my D note, I can approach it this way. Play the half step below the D, slide into the D. So now I'm just going to open it up and just play a little bit, try to not stick with all these rules. And also remember, it's a good idea sometimes to play just totally blindly. Don't think about the chords at all. Just know your scale is the C scale. Just play. Have a glass of wine. Put on the iRealB to play behind you and just play against it with the scale. Let your ear guide you. Your ear does instant music theory for you. It tells you what is sounding good and what is not. That's a good intuitive musical sense to develop. It's also good to develop the other side of the brain where you have to study things, you know, in a more detailed way and more consciously. Okay, so I'm just going to mix all this stuff up a little bit here. To mention that's important. Learn to play the tune with your scale. Just simply learn the melody that Hank Williams sings, right? Goodbye, Joe. Listen to the recording. I'm going to tell you it starts on an E note, and the first three notes are E, G, A. Right? And so on. Figure that out by ear. It's really good for your ear just to take a scale and just figure out a tune. I'll leave you with one last thought. There's a scale that's used very frequently in music called the pentatonic scale. It's a five-note scale. So another thing you could do with this tune is you could play a C pentatonic scale. The formula for C pentatonic or any pentatonic scale starting with a major scale is you start with the first note of the scale, you play one, two, three. In the key of C, it would be C, D, E. You skip the fourth note, you go to the fifth note, you go to the sixth note. So the notes in a pentatonic major scale are 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. You could apply that to the G chord as well. So you could start on G and say, okay, what's pentatonic on G? What's 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6? Well, if G is 1, A and B are 2 and 3. And then 5 is D, 6 is E. So a G pentatonic scale is G, A, B, D, E. C pentatonic scale, C, D, E, G, A. And you could just only play those notes as the chords change, and you'll get, you know, a sound that's, you know, applicable to the song that would be suitable. So here's what that would sound like. I'll just leave you with that, and then you can play with it on your own. Okay, stop. Gives you plenty to work on. Lots of stuff in this lesson. Take your time with it. Remember, this is video. You can go back to the beginning of the video. Just do first part of the video. Make sure you really absorb it. Go on to the next part. And take your time with it. And I hope you have fun. See you next time. Mm-hmm.